So now let's go to the alap, which I started with and then retracted back. So the alap or the alapana is the way we again say we introduce the raga, we elaborate the raga, we improvise the raga. I mean, there's no real word to describe what happens. But what are we actually doing? It's always difficult to break down these very abstract conceptual frameworks, but I'm making an attempt here. All of you have heard Hindustani music, right? Khyal or Dhrupad? Anybody who has not? Okay, that's wonderful. So I don't need to go into some things. Very good. So what is happening in the alap? So you have the notion of the raga. Raga is, again, a word that has very difficult... It's very difficult to describe a raga. It's, shall we say, a set of melodic possibilities that have been framed together. There are certain things, certain rules, or certain guidelines on which they are framed together. But they are melodic possibilities that have been brought together and said, okay, I think all you guys together form, there is a form in it. Let's keep you together. Now, what am I doing? I have that bundle of melodic possibilities. Where am I gathering it from? From the compositions I've learnt. Now I'm saying, okay, I'm going to render these possibilities. I'm going to go in between these possibilities. I'm going to maybe extend a possibility. I maybe by accident stumble upon a possibility that I have never sung. I'm not claiming nobody has, but I have never sung. All this I'm hoping for. I'm actually hoping for all this. I don't know. The one thing I know is I don't want a rhythmic structure. I know that for clear. So I'm saying, let me enter that. So what is my entrance point? Very important aspect of raga music, which is Indian music, is the sound of a raga. Most people talk about a raga in technicalities, but I think ragas have a sound. Every raga has a sound body. Now that sound body is what makes you believe it's that raga. So my first job is to create the illusion. It is an illusion. I buy into the illusion, you buy into the illusion. The illusion is to say, this is raga X. So I introduced you to possibilities that are there, which have been handed down to me, and dive myself into that illusion and dive you to that illusion. Once both of us have completely surrendered to the illusion, magic can happen. If either one of us have not surrendered to that illusion, magic cannot happen. Because then I'm always in doubt. Because I have not gotten to that sound. I have not gotten to that body. You're always in doubt. Is it this raga? Is it that raga? Maybe it's not. Maybe it is. Why are you in doubt? Because you have not surrendered to it. And I call it an illusion specifically. Because it is a beautiful illusion. Illusion is not a bad word. The greatness of art is to create illusion. Not delusion. Illusion. So we're not deluding ourselves. We're actually surrendering to something. So the first job as an artist is to say, let's create the sound of raga, whatever. And I use the phrases I know. And a phrase, what's a phrase? Just to give it very simply, it's a melodic possibility that has been, shall we say, defined as an identity marker for a raga. A melodic possibility that has been defined as an identity marker for a raga. Every raga has automatically multiple markers. So the first thing I do is introduce you to markers. Then we all come in, and then let's see what happens. I'm going to sing we're going to just try singing a raga. Like I said, I'm only trying. And also, because something is beautiful to listen to, don't think it's great art. Because something is beautiful to look at, don't think it is real art. When you feel something beyond the beauty that you're noticing, then there's a possibility there is art happening. You have to peel that layer and hope for something else to happen. And when that happens, maybe I'm also finding something that I have not found before. The name of this raga is Bhairavi. It has nothing to do with the Bhairavi that you know in khyal or in music. So this is an interesting situation. Most of you here don't have an illusion to buy into, right? Because you don't know what Bhairavi is. That's also another interesting possibility. When you actually don't know, if I had people who knew Bhairavi, then we are all committing quite. But this is interesting. So let's see what you would commit to. And maybe what you're committing to is what we are discussing here. It's better to just sing than speak. Is there a conscious thought? Answer is no. But is there, what am I responding to? So what is actually happening? The first is, I am invested in the oral sound of Bhairavi. I know the sound. I'm sorry, I can't speak of these things in very tactile and temporal fashions. They have to be spoken about in words that may not actually give you a handle and say, this is a microphone. I can't do that. And maybe sometimes it's good we can't do that. I'm actually doing one very simple thing. I have committed to the sound of Bhairavi. I've committed to its movements. And I'm actually listening to every movement that I am singing. And I'm not saying this is pa, ma, pa, da, pa. The notes are irrelevant. Those are building blocks. Is not the same as it's not the same. The notation of both is the same. All are different. So when I commit to the sound, I'm committing to every part of that phrase. Every part. And that is moving me to a possibility of another phrase. Na ra, na ra, na ra, 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 ra. Now, is this new? I don't know. Is this sounding like Bhairavi? Yes, that I know. So the creative spirit of an Alapana comes in this ability of the artist to constantly be living within that sound of that raga and allowing the sound to guide the artist into another possibility. Is it creative? As long as you are experiencing it as something that takes your breath away, it is the most supreme form of creativity. It's irrelevant whether this phrase has been sung before or not. And I can tell you, we all know this, and I use this as an example many times. We hear four people, we hear the same person, let's say, why four people? Same person singing the same song, okay? On four different occasions, but you cry only once. Why? The same song is sung four different times, but you cry only once. Let's, for argument's sake, say voice-wise, they were on the same level four times. What happened in that one time? Now, the fact that everything transcended in that one time is only the existence of creativity. That's all matters. So if anybody tells you that the creativeness is about standing on your head like a circus trick, or tells you that they sang a phrase that humanity has never sung, it can be the most uncreative happening. At the same time, something that has been sung for 400 years can still be the most creative happening. In an Alapana, all this is possible, irrespective of whether it is in Hindustani music or Carnatic music. He told me, he interrupted and said, you are singing from a level where you have understood it so well. First sing from a level where a beginner will understand how to sing Bhairavi. This is what he told me. I'm not sure exactly how to respond to that. But I'm going to try and sing maybe what could be looked at as a standard approach to Bhairavi. Okay? Why don't you sing actually? He sings well, sing.
No, sing.
He actually sings well. Irada maika. கூட பாடு வா. இடு பாடு சும்மா பாடு பாடு.
The difference what Krishna sang and what Chandrasekara Sharma sang what comes to my mind when Krishna started the Alapana or the Alap. I don't know whether you will accept that what I'm going to tell now, but still I want to tell that. The humility in which he approached the art. He knows Bhairavi. Everybody knows that he knows Bhairavi. But the way he started exploring the raga, he was just searching Bhairavi so beautifully, so with the, I will say, total surrender to the art form in all its humility. And he just goes through the notes so beautifully. And very important thing what he did was that Tanpura sound guided him beautifully. That Sajjamama, the Tanpura, the amount of Bhairavi he got from the Tanpura, he got, not everybody can get, he got that Sajjamama, that Panchamama, whatever notes that has been tuned in the Tanpura, that guided him so beautifully. And he just, he was on a journey towards, he's searching Bhairavi, can I get a good one, can I get a good one, can I get a good one. So that is the difference between singing Bhairavi by Krishna. And what Chandru sang was, he sang all the traditional phrases, exactly. I'm not demeaning Chandru or anything like that, please don't misunderstand me here. Because Krishna has been singing for so many years, and that experience and that Bhairavi, how much has gone into his mind already in his genes, comes out so beautifully, and every time he tries to give a new sound of Bhairavi. That's what I want to mean here.
Thank you. Just to add what he said about what Chandrasekara Sharma sang, he sang what is, if I was going to give you the framework of Bhairavi, what are the phrases, like I said, Bhairavi has phrases that, or forms, melodic possibilities. All these are melodic possibilities. It's a possibility. It's not the same. Is the possibility. Is not. Is a slight curve on it. This is what is happening. And I am not constructing something here. I am not constructing. Well, I am. Finally, it is constructed. But I am not constructing it. The construction is a happening when I am saying, when I hear that. When I hear that, it's happening. So, Alapana is this possibility of moving this. The freedom of the Alapana is that it's not structured in the Tala. Now, a couple of notions about Carnatic Alapanas. I have to come to that. One is, it is too short. So if I sang, this too we can sing. So if I approached it like this, a languorous way of approaching, then the sonic bandwidth of the raga changes. The what I would like to call the busyness probably reduces. Okay? But it doesn't mean that only if I sing a raga like this, am I really exploring the raga. This is one way of listening to the sound. That's all. You can listen to sound in so many ways. You can listen to sound standing in one place. You can listen to the sound walking with it. You can listen to the sound as it moves. This is of standing in one note and then allowing that one sound to then trickle into everything else. This is one way that the Carnatic musician sings Alapanas. Not always. I could also sing it. This is an unusual phrase, by the way. I can tell you now. I've not heard it in Bhairavi. That I've heard. Now, this is a different sense of responding and moving. Standing and building is a different sense of responding. So the perception that somehow, because we seem to be always on the move, Carnatic music is a music that's always on the move, that because of that there is no peace in the music, or that you're really not exploring it. I can sing a lot of very bad music by standing on one note for 15 minutes. Very bad music. Because I have a great voice and I can stand on one note for a long time and keep just moving up and down 3-4 times, don't think it's great. The question is, what are you experiencing when that's happening? That's the question. So this perception has to be really, really shattered. There are different ways. I can even start, another thing we do in Carnatic, we will start the raga anywhere. We could start a raga at the upper octave. The same raga, for example, a classic opening, old time openings. Now, this is a classic opening of Bhairavi. I can straight go there. And I don't need to sing all octaves every time. I have to. That is the day, that is the mood, that is the happening. That also depends on what composition am I going to follow it by. If I was going to follow it by a composition that's playing a lot on the upper octave, my raga will be more upper octave. This is faster. Another thing, peace in music, peace as in peace or calmness, is not got to do with the speed. It's got to do with the lack of agitation. Very different things. You can sing very fast music, which is actually peaceful. You can sing very slow music, which is so agitated. So another thing is, you think that the Alapana is, seems to be, no, it's not. It has a different frame. So I'm just trying to use this opportunity to speak of these simple things, because I think they're important things. The next time you listen to Carnatic music, at least you'll remember these little, what do you say, indicators I'm trying to share with you. That's why in Carnatic music, you have an Alapana which can be 20 minutes, which can be 3 minutes. I've said this before. You have Alapanas that's 3 minutes. Because sometimes in 3 minutes, a sweep has happened. There's nothing more to do. Sometimes, as you enter it, you're saying, wow, there's more. Let me just hang around here for a bit. And you keep hanging around. So we can't govern ourselves by time. Or more precisely, by the measure of time. Not time, but the measure of time. We govern ourselves by that possibility in the Alapana. So the Carnatic Alapana can sometimes start at the medium octave, go to the lower octave, slowly build like happens in Khayal 2, up to the upper octave and we come down. It can sometimes be just patches all over the place. Sometimes it can be only at the upper octave. This Alapana, the sense of the Alapana that you need to understand at a very basic level, that it is a free exploration within a sound of a raga. That's it. There is no rule, about what approach it needs to have or how long it needs to be, as long as all of us are guided by the sound of the raga at every moment of its happening. That's it. So Alapana is one way of exploring. I'll take another one, which is, these are all similar to even what happens in Hindustani music, slightly different. I'll take a different composition. I'll take one line of a composition of Dikshita. So when we render a composition, sometimes there are certain lines that offer the possibility of saying, you know, why don't you just explore what else you can do with this line? These are all, I think, gifts that we have in these compositions. There is no rule that only this line from a composition has been explored. A musician can choose any line. But there are certain things that you look for. For a line to be, shall we say, explored with a lot of pause and a lot of leisure, you generally need a line that does not have too many syllables. So the gap between the syllables are more. And I'll show you how it makes a difference. And there are a couple of things that we try to watch out for. We try to say, okay, nila nira da shari. See that the syllables have a certain spread, right? We try and keep the spread as it is there in the composition. I won't say we do it 100%, but more or less, we want the spread of the syllables. If I was going to utter them as syllables, ni, la, ni, ra, da, sha, ri, ra, dhi, ra, ta, ra, ni. This is the spread. I try to keep the spread. I don't necessarily sit on it as a rule. I try and say, let the spread remain more or less the same. That's what I try to do. And the Sangati was actually a clue of what we could do, which was taught by my teacher to me, which were small changes to the melody of a line. Now the possibility is, why don't you as a musician and a singer find different melodic movements in that line. So let's try a bit. Nila nira da sharira dira nila nira da tell you one thing, she's also playing the text. You should know that. So in an instrument, the text is emphasized through either a cut in the bow or the emphasis given to that point of the syllable. So I will just sing the line, just listen to whether you can hear those points. So neela neerada shari When she's also playing this form of exploration, it's called neraval. And the meaning of the word neraval is to fill, as they say in Tamil. So they say that's why it's called. So we are filling the gaps. This is something that can be sung extensively, can be sung in different speeds. I will just show you a sample of a couple of speeds maybe. We'll just sing for a bit. Neelam, neeradam. Sharira dira tarani nirada sharira dira tarani nirada questions at this point? Yes.
So I wanted to know, at this point, the mridangam and the ghatam was just providing a beat.
Yes.
It wasn't playing.
Now you will just watch them do different things. So again, that's also a question of slowly moving into. So they start by just giving us a frame. They know that we are melodically kind of moving all over the place. So the initial point is to say, okay, let's balance this out. Let's give them the baseline. So I don't need to worry about the frame. And then you will start watching both of them do something more. Just listen maybe two more rounds. Rendu neraval. Ullavasi. Rendu peru. Neelam. Neeradam. Shariram. Dheeram. Start building. He will slowly start building. And then as I get more, shall we say, with more filigree work, then he will start playing more filigree work. So that's how they respond. So the very important aspect is they are constantly listening and invested in what was happening here. Not just getting us back in track. Now, if I start singing the next speed, so depends on what we are doing. It's very important that, by the way, sometimes even giving the frame is part of allowing something to happen. So it's not, that's also part of the listening. Because they also need us to settle down, need us to kind of get into kind of a groove, as you say. So sometimes the groove is also their entry point that happens. Yes.
To go back to something you were saying 20 minutes ago about peacefulness, two versions of, can you give an example of the two kinds that you were talking about?
I don't know exactly. I said that you could have different forms.
It's not speed, but it's the,
yes.
It's so, not.
Very busy, it was always moving, but there's no panic. There is absolutely no panic here. He wants me to sing with panic now. It's very difficult for me to do it. Okay, let's make an attempt. I won't say we'll succeed, but we'll try. Na idhe tone la paadrana tone mathala seriya nee I tried.
Crystal clear now.
So it's possible. So that's what I'm saying. That's what I meant by saying. There's so many different kinds of experiences of peace. Let's not, sometimes we bring that down also to one homogeneous notion, no? But actually there are many ways. So this nirabal singing, or what we call it, can be done at multiple speeds with different kind of filigree work, different movements, and we're all participating. Another thing I want to tell you is that this is a conversation also that both of us are having between Subbalakshmi and me. So she is responding to what I may have offered, and I'm also taking from her. She may just throw up a curveball, as they call it, and I have to pick that curveball up if I am listening. It's possible that both of us are also completely tone deaf to each other. That also happens. And that just becomes a mechanical notion of music. But when we're listening, sometimes like, wow, that's interesting, and I'll immediately pick it up, or she picks up something. So there's a lot of this happening also in the music.